Dr. Ali. She is one of the leading experts on women issues in the Middle East as well as Sudan. Dr. Ali was in Juba a few months back, where the civil society organization in South Sudan had convened a big conference to discuss women's issues and women's role in the post-referendum Sudan. And I just want to briefly ask her, what was the meeting about and what was the outcome from that meeting?
Right. Thank you so much, Christopher, also for your kind words. I think that there are many women who have you know, the experience and the skills to enable them to constitute experts on the Middle East and Africa elsewhere. Thank you so much. I went to two conferences actually in Sudan, in Juba in particular. One was last year, and it was organized by my sister's keeper. It was a meeting for women's groups from all over Sudan to discuss various issues that have to do with women, but also it involved training. And then the second conference was organized by the South Sudan Women's Empowerment Network, and it took place in February in Juba. And that conference focused particularly on gender and women's rights and post-referendum arrangements. And so, as you know, last June, the two parties to the negotiations met in Mekelle, and they decided to narrow down the discussions. So there are so many issues outlined in the CPA on post-referendum arrangements. So they decided to focus, to narrow them down into four clusters. And these are citizenship, security arrangements, economic and natural resources, including the oil sector, and finally international agreements. And so the conference was organized around these four clusters or themes. Women from different parts of Sudan were divided into groups, and in each group they discussed one of these themes. And the women came up with with the assistance of gender experts from Sudan and from outside Sudan. The women thought about how these issues affect women and men differently, and on whether they had recommendations for the negotiating partners and also for the AU, which is overseeing the whole process. And this is what the women had discussed at the time. They came up with general recommendations that have to do with the importance of better participation for women and for other segments, including civil society, in the process itself, and for them to be able to feed into the process. They also came up with a general recommendation on the importance of opening up the process, and at least providing information to different stakeholders outside Sudan who would be affected by the outcome of the negotiations in the future. And of course, some of the other issues that the women discussed had to do with ongoing the conflict in Darfur. They also discussed issues that became post-referendum issues. They are outstanding. They were supposed to be sorted before the referendum. And those include APA, of course, the referendum in APA. They include border demarcation. They include other factors as well. So different issues that became post-referendum issues. So.
I read the statistics on the fate of women in South Sudan, which is very slightly different. There are similarities, but there are also differences between women in Northern Sudan or in all the mountainous areas, as well as women in South Sudan.
Yes.
And it said one in six women dies during childbirth.
Right.
And the literacy rate in South Sudan is, I think, 87% of the population is illiterate. And more specifically with women, it's even more, and this is, you have both statistics, women are worse off in the north in literacy as well in the south, except in the south it's just a bit more acute than it is in the north. What do you think is one of the biggest challenges that the government of South Sudan will have to address moving forward?
Right, so you already mentioned the biggest challenges actually. I think that one of the key challenges is that South Sudan has some of the poorest development indicators in the whole world. That is the result of years of conflict, and it's also the result of years of marginalization by successive Indian governments, whereby development schemes were mainly concentrated in the north to develop these issues soon because they would have to deal with lack of infrastructure. So maternal mortality is a problem in itself, but it's also connected to lack of infrastructure, lack of hospitals, problems with the health system, lack of trained personnel, health personnel. It has to do with women's inability to
have access to prenatal care, to obstetric care when they are, you know, when they're giving birth, if there are complications. So it's called emergency obstetric care. It's fortunate that I came to know recently that the WHO and UNFPA and other stakeholders are actually working with the government to address the issue of maternal mortality. But it's going to take time. It's going to take time. It has to do with prioritization as well. The security agenda, for example, is very high right now on the agenda of both governments in the north and in the south. And this is likely to be at the expense of, you know, a focus on issues such as, you know, maternal mortality, access to education, and otherwise. But these are important issues, and the focus on solving this problem is really going to enhance the legitimacy of the new government in South Sudan, the new South Sudan.
Dr. Ali, ladies and gentlemen, thank you for your time, and it was really nice having you.
Thank you so much, Christopher.